This isn't about capturing a perception with the brush. It's not about painting forms that resemble, through outline and color, real objects. It's about recreating the object itself by simulating in paint the inner structure of its materials. The effect is a remarkable illusion that what we see is real and not painted. Yet it is all just paint. And this is what amazes me most about Jan Van Eyck. Earlier painting can be exquisite in its own way with elegant lines and plausible details. While parts of these pictures are painted, the artists pursue their effects inconsistently. The most vivid example of this is when it comes to the representation of gold and jewels, something that much of the painting of the time uses to signify holiness. It's notable that Van Eyck didn't use gold leaf to represent gold objects in his pictures. Instead, he painted objects as golden. He never introduced foreign elements into his picture. He never placed upon the panel that he works, for example, an actual jewel. That was common in the period before Jan Van Eyck. He creates a consistent surface. And that consistency allows the picture to achieve another order of consistency, namely that whatever is in the picture appears consistent with the world outside of the picture. That is, that the whole picture builds up an illusion of a global consistency which we ourselves inhabit. So to the viewer, the illusion of his paintings, the fiction of the painted world as real, never breaks. And if these pictures look real to us today, what might they have looked like when they were first painted?
It's hard for us to imagine today how Van Eyck's pictures would have been understood by people of the time. Today, we're bombarded by virtual realities which make even photographs look inert. Remember what pictures looked like before Van Eyck. Certainly, the culture was filled with images, yet these looked like man-made artifacts, like beautiful things in the world, rather than like windows open to the world. To what then could Van Eyck's pictures be compared? Only to natural images, which is to say, to reflections, such as could be most vividly observed in mirrors.
This picture of the canon George van der Pele before the Virgin and Child shimmers with reflected light. It shows the cleric brought in front of the Virgin by his patron saint, Saint George, the figure in armor. Jan van Eyck deliberately fills the scene with reflective surfaces, inviting viewers to observe the similarity between painting and the mirrors that painting can depict. These surfaces multiply the world around. The saint's armor even reflects the artist himself, working on the painting we behold. A sentence written on the frame adds meaning to these reflections. It compares the Virgin to perfectly reflected light with God as the illuminating source. Van Eyck's picture then is like the Virgin, being itself a mirror of that same light from God. Today, painters get their paint ready-made in tubes. But the forgotten alchemy of pigments that Van Eyck mastered still fascinates.
Part of the reason his innovations in oils are so important is because they haven't been improved on. It's absurd to think that given all the other innovations over the centuries, oil painting is still the best way of depicting a human being in a two-dimensional form.
It's because of the way in which you can use glazes to suggest a certain kind of vibrancy of the light and reflections, which make it feel like there's something coming out of the picture towards you. But also, you can use it in the dark colors to suggest space going away behind. Plus, because it stays wet for a little while, if someone comes to sit for you a day or two later, and you see something, see them in a different way, you can put that in straight into the picture rather than having to start a whole other layer over the top.
Even photography, with all its huge benefits and exciting innovations, still can't create the same illusions that a painting can when it's there because of the way the oil painting is built up in layers. And those layers play games with the light in a way that nothing else can do. It's hard now to just imagine what life was like in art terms before that, before he was around.
Almost more than any other product, paintings are the embodiment of labor. They require not particularly expensive materials. They're made just out of oil and pigments, some expensive, but broadly speaking, inexpensive compared to gold and jewels. And what makes them valuable is the labor that went into making them.
Jan van Eyck's labor raised the status of painting almost immediately. The illusions he created were so convincing that in some ways painting could hide that it was painting. And since his products didn't look handmade, he could claim a higher status than that of mere craftsmen working with his hands.
But there were also advantages to consumers. Instead of paying for gold and jewels, now they could buy painted substitutes at a fraction of the cost. So to whom did this new art appeal? The Bruges archive holds an amazing collection of records, dating back to the early 15th century, when Bruges was the economic hub of Europe, full of wealthy merchants. The townspeople who lived and worked here noted all the important events in the life of their town. And one of these remarkable records takes us back to the birth of a whole new market for painting. This is an important piece of the puzzle. It's an extraordinary document. Dated 1432, it records a visit made by the city magistrates and the mayor to the atelier of Jan van Eyck in Bruges. It speaks of their wanting to see the work of his assistants, which means that by this point, Van Eyck's not working alone, but that he has already an extensive workshop. It also indicates the interest that the citizenry took already in Van Eyck's art. The visit of the Bruges magistrates, documented here, marks the beginning of a long mutual relationship between a new type of painting and a new urban elite.
And the kind of painting they desired more than any other was a portrait of themselves.
A portrait is and ever was a lasting memorial to you. It's something that grants you posterity. It's something your family will keep and value. Portraits had been only there for saints and kings. The new portrait painting allows more modest families to have a replica of Grandpa that can be hung on the living room wall. That's a new idea. It also allows you to say, I have had the great Van Eyck paint my portrait. Courts of kings and dukes of Burgundy get Van Eyck portraits. This tells you how important I am. There's a fashion for having yourself painted. It's a very secular urge because this isn't on an altarpiece. This isn't somewhere where people will say he's very godly, but it is a conspicuous way of showing that you are a match for princes.
Jan van Eyck excelled in portraiture, and he created innovative devices such as the three-quarter view, where the sitter turns halfway towards a profile position. Still today, the classic portrait format. After Van Eyck, portrait painting became a kind of industry, Its master was the Bruges painter Hans Memling. Memling took Van Eyck's innovative format and developed it with backgrounds and more detail. His work is remarkable as a document of the people who lived in Bruges and Flanders almost 600 years ago. But in Van Eyck's hands, portraiture does more than simply record a person's physical appearance. It realizes, in the form of a concrete vision, the sitter's deepest spiritual desires as well. This is one of Jan Van Eyck's most celebrated works. It's a painting of the most important man in the administration of the Dukes of Burgundy, the chancellor of the entire Burgundian realm, a man named Nicholas Rolin. Rolin rose from a humble estate to become one of the most powerful men in Europe. One chronicler wrote that it was humanly impossible to imagine how rich Nicholas Rolin was. To enter Rolin's world, we need to go to an extraordinary place south of Dijon and encounter there the work of another supreme Flemish painter. It's an altarpiece painted by the great painter Roger van der Weyden, who emerged slightly later than Van Eyck and who developed under Van Eyck's influence. Commissioned by Nicholas Rolin, it was painted in Flanders and transported here. Nicholas Rolin was a master calculator. He was the chief administrator of Europe's wealthiest region, and he knew how to turn a profit on every transaction he handled. Like others of the time, Rolin believed that heaven had an economy too, but a different one than here on earth. This idea of a divine calculation appears at the center of the great Last Judgment altarpiece that Rolin commissioned for his hospital here in Beaune. Like the Ghent altarpiece, this great ensemble has been moved out of its original home. It once sat just across the courtyard from its current position in the chapel of the Charity Hospital dating from the early 15th century, entirely funded by Nicholas Rolin. The sick would have laid in beds like these, and from there they could have seen the altar and the mass celebrated for them. On ordinary days, with the altar closed, they would have seen a portrait of their benefactor, Rolin. And on feast days, when the altar opened up, they could have beheld a spectacle of the fate that awaited them. And from that spectacle, God himself would look down upon them and beyond them to the spectacle of Nicholas Rolin's own generosity. His hospital with its altarpiece would have been a striking public show of generosity. The picture he commissioned from Jan Van Eyck is both an emblem of piety and an inventory of Rolin's staggering wealth. It shows Rolin praying to the Virgin and Christ who appear beside him. But the painting invites us to pass beyond this foreground dialogue to the extraordinary landscape that opens up behind them. Van Eyck draws our eye there by placing on the parapet, at the exact geometric center of his panel, two figures. One, dressed in a red turban, is probably Jan Van Eyck himself. He shows his companion the view just as his painting allows us to see it. And what he shows is his life world, a bustling northern European trade city built upon a river open to the world. And behind Rolin, we find one amazing detail, vineyards.
This is the world into which Van Eyck sends us as he launches our eye into that glorious view. Among his vast possessions, Rolin owned vineyards in Burgundy, such as these. Already then, Burgundy produced some of Europe's finest wines. Vineyards generated the region's wealth, and they contributed to Rolin's riches, and thus, in a way, made possible Van Eyck's picture itself.
By showing Roland's vineyards, Van Eyck takes